Welcome to the Damcasters, brought to you in association with the Pima Air and Space Museum. I'm your host, Matt Bone. One of the great wartime commanders in the Second World War was Air Vice Marshal Don Bennett, and his career spans years of aviation, and he's most famous because he was the commander of the Pathfinder Force, and this is his biography, first edition and everything. He was someone who didn't suffer fools, shall we say, and was very proudly Australian, and that came across in some of the score settling that he includes in this book. Now, a couple weeks ago on our aircrew book review show with Andy Wright, Andy and I discussed a new biography of Don Bennett, which is called Relentless Skies, and it is all about Don's life in volume one up until he is given command of the Pathfinder Force by Arthur Harris. So it's all of the stuff that he did before the war and in the first few years of it, which to me is the interesting bit, because that's record setting for Imperial Airways, flying boats for the RAF, lots of fascinating things in his life there. So it was great to sit down with the book's author, Ian Campbell, who's the curator of the Bennett Vial Archive at the Queensland Air Museum, to discuss what went into writing this book about Don, because as he says, it felt like Don was moving in with him and his wife. This is part one of two, and we will be delving into all things Don Bennett for the next couple of weeks here on the Damcasters. Of course, if you want all of this together in one big episode, join us on Patreon. Become a Damcasteer from just £3 a month, plus a bit of VAT. You get all these episodes compressed into one big long one, special intro from me with updates and things. And you support the pod, help keep the lights on, and we can do lots of fun things. I'm also delighted to say that our title sponsors at the Pima Air and Space Museum will be continuing to sponsor the show, so we'll be doing some fun stuff over the new year as well. Unfortunately, we didn't get out to see the Martin Mars, which, as this drops, probably still wouldn't have arrived in Tucson. So be sure to check out www.pimaair.org for more information from them. And let's get into this, because in our review of the book, now, Andy Wright, who we had on the other week, edited Relentless Skies, which I shall hold up once again so you can all see the cover, and we both said it was superb. And Ian, quite rightly, as the author, challenged me to explain why. So that's where we're going to start. And I think I do an okay job, but the book really is superb, as you're going to find out, because Ian is a great guy. Over to Ian.
I was genuinely interested in that when you actually write a biography, you're writing to do a certain thing and place emphasis in certain directions. And when you have people come back, they will read it in different ways. They will see it through different prisms, different lights, different experiences. And I was just interested that part of the reason that you're talking to me now is because you had responded positively to it. So I'm very happy for you to comment, or we can talk about it at the end. I was just fascinated from a personal perspective as to what had actually grabbed you. And then you said, well, really need to talk.
Yeah, well, biographies are funny things. We can just throw this in now. I think, you know, it's people can write them from different angles. And I think there's this hagiography ones, which are, you know, you're Andrew Roberts writing about Churchill being the greatest man who ever lived and not looking at the rough edges, or you have someone trying to take someone down. I think the best ones, and this is where, you know, Andy and I were talking about when it came to your book on Don, was you took him for who he was through his papers, through the research, through his own writings, of which his own memoirs fabulously bitchy in places. It's brilliant, but you didn't knock off the rough edges, especially of that sort of youthful vigor of him coming up as well. And I think, as you said to me when we were chatting as well, it's a Queenslander looking at a Queenslander, and I think that's key for getting the spirit of the person that you're writing about across. And that's what stood out to me. It's wonderfully readable as well, which makes it superb. You know, and Andy was saying on our previous show that, you know, you didn't really have to do a lot, which I suppose for an editor is high praise indeed. But for me, it was you took the, you took your character in Don for what he was, and then you took us through his life and the reasons why he was who he was. And I found that a very compelling journey. And I love where you broke the book as well, because I think that's it's a natural natural point for what comes. You know, volume two will be the one that everybody kind of knows him for, whereas volume one is all the stuff that a lot of people may not, which is what we're going to talk about today.
It was interesting to me. What came through was, as I explored his early life, was just how many points of connection there were with my family life. Now, I'm originally from Canberra. I've lived here for well over 20 years. But once I started looking at the whole issue of coming when he was born in Toowoomba and mm-hmm. came from there down into Brisbane, and that they were living at Kellett Street in Auchenflower, and when I was reading about him working on his dad's cars, for instance, and that he would get them out on the road and he would hare around and he would give conniptions to the neighbours. Well, I drove round to 6 Kellett Street, Auchenflower Park, parked up the road, walked down because I didn't want to scare the people by standing in front and staring at their house, whoever lives there now. But the original house is still there, and it's on a very steep incline. And I'm thinking, I can, and it ends at an intersection at the bottom of the hill, and I can imagine Don having done the engine over for the umpteenth time as a teenager, as he gets in the car and he goes screaming down the street, and all the neighbours are going, oh my goodness, he's going to hit something. Now, that is just in the suburb next door to where my maternal grandparents lived, and I would come and visit very often from Canberra. And then my paternal grandparents, who lived out west of their ancestors lived out west of Brisbane and close to Toowoomba. And then the whole thing of him going to Brisbane Grammar School. So I made an appointment to go into Brisbane Grammar School, and that was my father's alma mater. And he was a generation behind Don. But to be shown around the school and to be shown into the archives, and then there's the wonderful story that I put in there, which I won't we won't breach now, about what his mum did in terms of a small present to the school to demonstrate just how well her youngest son was going. All these connections in with my family, and I'm going, this isn't an Air Vice Marshal and this isn't a pioneer aviator. This is just a young kid who grew up west of here and then had his teenage years in the inner suburbs of Brisbane. His father was a real estate agent in Queen Street. Queen Street's just one of the major streets in downtown Brisbane. The building is no longer there, of course, there's modern buildings there, but all these points of connection. And so I really wanted to capture this idea that he was just born Don, and he went on to do amazing things, to break world records and to help in the strategic air offensive during the Second World War. But that's not how he was born. And I very much love that Jesuit dictum that give me a child to the age of 7 and I'll show you the man. And so it was very important to me, where previous biographies had skipped over his early life or done it in a very, very summary fashion, to actually explore it in detail so that I had a very, very solid foundation upon which to look at the various stages of his life as they unfolded.
And I think that's a key point. So many of the works on Don kind of start at that pivotal moment when he's given command of the Pathfinder Force. And then they talk about the things he did before. This is what brought him here, but this is the thing. And I think that journey to the point, which isn't in this book, of course, is all the more fascinating, because for me, as someone who's read a lot about him, I've always found the stuff either side of the war more interesting. The bits we're going to talk about today about Mercury and stuff, and then the British South American Airways things, the looking for the lost Lancastrian and things like that. All of these fascinating aspects of his life, I think, are sort of that bookends those incredible 3 years. He's just such a makes for such a remarkable moment, man.
And I think this is one of the issues that I had was, and I found this interestingly on Monday night at the launch, with in terms of the questions that were asked, is that because he is best known as Air Officer commanding the Pathfinder Force, people want to see his earlier life and his later life principally through that lens. And really what I wanted to do in ending Volume 1 on the very day that Bomber Harris calls him into his office at High Wycombe and says, listen, I'm appointing you to command the Pathfinder Force, to say that there is an entire life which stands on its own, in and of itself. Volume 1 is complete in itself. There is a Volume 2 to come, which looks at Pathfinder Force and British South American Airways and air flight and Berlin Airlift and the GACP crash and all other things is yet to come. But you can read the first volume and be satisfied with the first volume on the basis that that there is an awful lot in there for you to absorb. And then it stands as a foundation for all that is to come. And you don't get the possibility of evaluating his life to that point through the lens of being AOC of the Pathfinder Force.
And I guess that's a bit of a shorthand, isn't it? We tend to look at men who were prominent within, you know, the Second World War as that sort of way into people. Whereas I think the way you've approached it as well, that this sort of journey to it, and then as you will do beyond, in Volume 2 is a lot of, for me as a reader, it's a lot of fun because there's so much that I learned that I never knew about him in your book.
Well, thank you for that. And I think the other thing is, this is my second biography. I followed a similar principle to the way I did the first, which is rather than reading everything and then working out a framework and then writing, is I really wanted to go the journey with the subject. And although obviously I had read things and I had been through various things in the archive that related to later parts of his life, what I wanted to do with Don was to follow the journey, as I had with Keith Watson in Thinks He's a Bird, is to follow that journey, and you get this sense of it unfolding for you as it unfolds for your subject. And certain things that unfold in the plot that you hadn't quite anticipated. And I think we'll get to this later when we talk about his flights with Mercury, is all of a sudden this paperwork turns up in the archive related to all the things that he wanted to do, but he never got to do with Mercury. But because that was a dead end for him, he skipped over that in his memoirs. They never got mentioned. And I'm looking at hand-drawn maps and all sorts of things that he had done, going, oh my goodness, there's an entire part of his life that he spent time on, which he just conveniently forgot to put in. Now, there is a little thing that I want to mention now, is that as I finished the first volume, what turned up from elsewhere wasn't in the collection but had been held outside the museum was the original manuscript of his memoirs, which had gone to the publisher, had come back with corrections from the publisher, and then his either acceptance of those corrections, or his absolutely no, we're going to say it just as exactly as I want to say it, or various points. And it's got his handwriting all over. I know his handwriting back to front now. And there are things that he wrote in that original manuscript which never made it into his memoirs. Now, his memoirs were feisty enough. But that is the great joy then of in coming to the second volume, for instance, and it has more pertinence to the second volume, as you might expect, where he's making various comments about things. So just to drop that in at this point.
I cannot wait to hear about some of those comments.
Yeah.
Because the stuff that makes it in is quite...
That's right.
Feisty is probably the best way to put it.
There have been questions asked over the years as to whether he really... because he was never a good speller, as to whether, in fact, he got the spelling of Ralph Cochrane's surname incorrect because he didn't know how to spell it, or was that a deliberate act? So those sorts of things. I went through it to see whether, in fact, there was anything revealing in the first, with regard to the first volume that I had missed, and there wasn't. So there wasn't any need to make any changes. But it's certainly going to be wonderful to explore those things in the second volume.
Thoroughly looking forward to it. But for most people, they probably haven't had a chance to read volume one. So I suppose we should really talk about that, shouldn't we? One thing that came up in my chat with Andy, and we've talked about on email, is you've said that your subjects sort of move in with you, and you had Keith for a while and he moved out and Don moved in. How did your wife cope with having Don as a roommate with you as well?
Well, it started with Keith, and I said to somebody who had assisted me with the research for that first volume, thinks he's a bird on the Pathfinder, Lancaster pilot, Flight mm-hmm. Lieutenant Keith Watson, that I spent a year to get inside his head, and then I couldn't get him out of mine. And so he moved in, and my wife expressed the view after 3 years of research and writing that perhaps now it would be a good idea if Keith moved out. And then at one point she looked at me as I was getting into the Bennett Archive at the Queensland Air Museum, and she said, "Now let me guess, Don's going to move in." And I said, "Look, I'm afraid that's the case." And it was about a year as well. It's interesting how long it takes to actually, when you are at that point where you're not only thinking your thoughts, but in any particular situation, you're actually going, "Well, I know what Don would do here." And so that then produced this process over time of, well, look, in what way are Don and I alike? And in what way is this new head fellow that I have dissonant? And he's like me, and I've written down a few things. He's like me, sets very high standards, especially for himself, for ourselves. He was very introverted, and he was also very highly focused. Once he got his eyes on something, he would stay on that, and he would focus on it until he had mastered it. But we are not alike. We are very bad head fellows in different ways. And that is, with regard to empathy, I have much more empathy than Don. Though he didn't lack it completely, he was not without empathy. He just didn't prioritize people's feelings. Most people, or a lot of people like me, have a combination of thinking about both people and task. He was just task focused. People-oriented. And they would say, people who worked with him would say, "Well, look, it would have been nice if he'd actually said, well, thank you very much for what you've just done." That would never have occurred to Don, because he would assume everybody was focused on achieving the goals as well. I'm a person who doesn't like conflict. The whole idea of avoiding conflict would never have entered Don's mind at all. It just didn't. He didn't rate that as an issue. And so he would just carry on into situations. And if it caused conflict, well, that was just sort of things that people had to get over. I have a degree of patience. You raised my wife. My wife would say I've got extraordinary patience with some things and very little patience for others. Don had no patience for anything. It was all about just getting on. And the other thing is, and this is critically important, is that I'm a risk-averse person, but he is somebody who took risks, but it was after he had made assessments about his ability to deal with that risk, his level of planning would go up or down in accordance with the risk that he perceived, etc. So he wasn't about avoiding risk, but he was about mitigating it to the greatest possible extent. But one of the key narrative threads, which is going to go through volume one and volume two, is what I perceive to be his changing relationship with risk. And it's going to become more manifest in volume two. We'll come to this with regard to the Atlantic Ferry, where we see the level of planning, the micro planning that went into the Atlantic Ferry flights was just extraordinary. But there is this relationship with risk that I found absolutely fascinating.
Hmm.
So that's Don in my head.
Which must have made for, as you were unpicking him, must have made for some interesting conversations with yourself to see how your view of him changed over the process of writing the book. Or was it the same all the way through? I don't know.
Well, it's very interesting because I had numbers of people who have said to me, as I've talked a bit about Don, do you like him or not? Mm. Which in itself was an interesting question. And my answer was, it doesn't matter. It's not an issue for me whether I like him or not. The issue is to whether I can understand him and portray him accurately from the framework of my personal character. Mm. And I had to pull myself back on occasions. For instance, Don could be very sarcastic, and I'm not inclined so much towards sarcasm, but I can be a little bit cynical at times. And if there were things that I thought that Don was doing that perhaps would draw a degree of cynicism, is I would have to pull myself back and then go back into a dialogue to with Don in that sense. I don't want to make it sound too spooky, but that where I'm going, no. How are you seeing it, Don? So that I'm not actually overlaying. And you need to bear in mind, look, I'm a guy in my mid-60s now, and we're talking about a guy leading up in volume one is going for his first 31 years of his life. There are certain things that he is going to do for which he has no experience, no life experience. He's got a particular outlook on life, which is a bit different to mine. So you have to pull yourself up and make sure that your writing is not being unduly influenced by your own personal character assessment of him.
Which comes across, and I think that's an interesting thing there about the light question is, you're not going to have a beer with this guy. You're trying to get under his skin as much, and that's an important distinction.
I would have loved to have had a beer with him, but he wouldn't have liked to have one with me. He was not for social occasions. We will talk a bit about Lee. She was much better at social occasions than him. And I think that he probably would have been looking at his watch or turning over the drinks coaster and getting his trusty pencil out. We've got his trusty pencil at the museum. It's a wonderful thing to hold, knowing that, in fact, he'd used it across a whole pile of paper that I'm looking at. But no, he would have been entirely bored by having me as a conversationalist, aside from the fact I would have been asking him too many questions that he didn't particularly want to answer.
Well, let's get into it. We've briefly sort of touched on those sort of early days in Brisbane and growing up there. But what was that sort of early life like, the sort of route through grammar school? Because one of the things that jumped out at me was it when the aviation side of it kicked in, his schooling, his grades and things got better, which is chimed with me, because when I started doing aviation at college, I suddenly decided that I actually liked school. Was that similar for him, that when he had that task and that route, things lifted, as opposed to, because you said in the book he was going to go off and run the farm at one point, was the family farm at one point?
Well, his family, it was middle class family. His father was a real estate agent. His mother was a homemaker. She herself was British, had come out from England in the 1870s. He had three older brothers, so he was the runt of the litter, and they had come through as lawyer, doctor. Lawyer. Two of them had been ducks of the school, and he came through at the end born in 1910, and it was expected that he would be a doctor. His grandfather, maternal grandfather, had been a doctor, a well-known eccentric by the name of Thomas Pennington Lucas, inventor of Australia's famous pawpaw ointment, which he claimed could cure everything from constipation to cancer. They were the Bennett's lived inner city Brisbane during his teenage years. They were part of the local small business environment. They were quite social people. And it was expected that their sons, who were all very bright, would excel academically at school. And of course, the first three did. Don went to one of our premier schools in Brisbane, the Brisbane Grammar School, renowned for the number of famous people it's turned out over the years, but school bored him. And I think that this, he had an exceptional level of intelligence and he had a capacity to absorb information at an absolutely amazing rate. He was something of a polymath, an autodidact polymath, as they would say. So he could pick up anything and he could learn it very quickly. But if it was of no interest to him, he paid no attention to it at all. So I think that as far as grammar school was concerned, he brought to it what I would call a differently constituted mind. And so if it was of no interest to him, he ignored it completely. If it was of great interest to him, he didn't need to put any work into it at all. He just mastered it straight away. So school life was just a waste of time for him. He was much more interested in cars. So he self-taught with mechanics and things and would disassemble his father's car and put it together. And his father, George, encouraged that. Two younger boys, Don and his brother Arnold, they loved camping and canoeing and surfing on the Gold Coast and all those sorts of things. And going out to their father's property, which is a 30,000-acre property west of Brisbane called Canimbla, and spent a lot of time out there learning to be jackaroos. And so there was an awful lot outside of school life, which he really responded to much more than school. And so at the end of October 1927, his father, having got his latest grades from school and him being a self-proclaimed loafer, pulled him out of school and said, look, I'm not going to put any more money into school or into possibility of university or anything like that. You're just going to stop here and think about what you're going to do with your life. Well, initially, he left school and went to work for his father in the real estate agency, and that bored him. So his dad said, well, look, why don't you contemplate running the family station at Canimbla, out west of Brisbane? So he went out there, and that's where he was for 3 months. And that was the first time he'd actually stopped to seriously think about what he was going to do with his life. And he ruled out all the things. He was not going to be a lawyer. He was not going to be a doctor. He was not going to be a real estate agent. And he was bored to death on the farm as well. So he was not going to run the family station. So he came back to Brisbane having determined that he was going to have a career in aviation. Well, you can imagine how that went down. This is early 1928. And his parents weren't impressed. But at that point, once he makes the decision, he's instantly focused. He joins the citizen forces, what we now call the Army Reserve. He goes and does extra science subjects at the Central Technical College. And he says he reads absolutely everything he can get his hands on with regard to aviation. And also shortly after that, he gets involved in working on a farm and aircraft with a friend of the family's, and so he's learning some aircraft mechanics and all those sorts of things, and he just loves it. Absolutely brilliant. And then at that point, 1928, we also see Amy Johnson arrive, we see Bert Hinkler arrive, we see Southern Cross with Kingsford Smith. They're all coming in that year, and the family who have an interest in aviation, his dad at least, anyway, gets them out to see all these things. And so this is stimulating him. And he's going, yes, this is absolutely what I want to do. So having gone from it being complete loafer at school, he's taken his intelligence, he's self-taught, and he's applying it to this whole area of aviation. And that's where he gets started. And he decides off to the RAAF.
And he lands in an interesting place because from the way you describe it, Point Cook is this fascinating sort of hotbed of the Australian Air Force, isn't it? It's the place to be at a time when you have the constraints of the financial problems coming in as well as and things. It seemed like a very fascinating time to go through Point Cook, and Don seems to have made the most of it while he was there.
It would be regarded as the Australian equivalent of Cranwell. Mm-hmm. And it was on the bay at Port Phillip Bay. So they could have land-based planes and they could also have flying boats. He didn't fly the flying boats at that stage, but he loved his time there. He came top in the flying training, but he came second overall to Clary Smith. I don't think that Clary Smith was ever forgiven for Donald Bennett coming second. It stirred him a touch, but he was so happy to come out top in flying. He did fall in love with the flying then, as a lot of pilots would tell you that they do, those early years when you're getting aloft by yourself. It was interesting that when I was looking at his logbooks and also the various records around that, that he wasn't showing necessarily a supreme aptitude in navigation, which is obviously what his forte would be ultimately. There were certain exercises he didn't complete. Now, that may have been due to the Melbourne weather, which is notoriously fickle. But he's much, much, much more interested in the whole thing around engines, mechanics, electronics. This is the thing that really stirs him along. And we have his two notebooks, lecture notes, from his time there. And the amount of information that he puts down about engines and how they function and how to make them work best. And, of course, he is absorbing all of this. It's all going in and not coming out. And this is this great nerdishness that he brings to everything, all the way through to Pathfinder Force and beyond, is he's never happier than when he's actually out fiddling with an engine, or he's reading about the latest piece of equipment, or whatever. So we think of him as that preeminent pilot or leader or navigator or whatever, but his core interests lay around his mechanics, the electronics, the technical things. And he was always wanting, what's the latest thing? How do we use it? How do we best use it?
You made an interesting point there. At this point, he's sort of on a track to be a fighter jock, isn't he? He's the multi-engine things, it hasn't really come into it yet. What was there anything at Point Cook that sort of was pushing him that way before he came up to England and the RAF?
No, I don't know that he had contemplated anything other. They learnt on the Cirrus Moth and then the Westland Wapiti, but they were, due to the funding constraints through the Depression, he and his colleagues had to sign up to what was called a short service commission, which would be they would get their wings training at Point Cook, but they would have to spend 4 years in England with the RAF. And he simply progressed from getting his wings at Point Cook to England to 29 Squadron at North Weald, where they were on Siskins. And he had had no exposure to multi-engine aircraft, and so I don't think that he was even contemplating it at that stage. But as soon as, if we're going to England now, as soon as he had mastered the Siskin, which he said was notoriously difficult to fly, but I think he appreciated it because it helped him learn a few things, and there is an accident, which we won't talk about at this point, while he was at North Weald. Once he had mastered the Siskin, he's just looking for another challenge. And this is the consistent picture about Don, and it will come into the second volume as well, is that once he has mastered something, he gets bored, he needs a new challenge, and he wants to move on. It doesn't matter what it is. He is not really interested in the concept of career as people would understand career, as you might say in the RAF, is move up through the ranks into more and more senior positions and positions of authority. If he gets bored in any particular job, it's, okay, what's next? What's going to give me the biggest challenge or the newest thing to learn or the next horizon to cross?
And that, amazingly, is flying boats, which it seems a jump. Having had the pleasure of knowing a few fighter pilots, the idea of them going on to something like that would be something else. But I guess that this all starts feeding into, as you were just saying, it's that challenge and the additional elements that come into it. I suppose night flying as well.
Well, it seemed to me in looking at this move was that for somebody who is very much a loner, an introvert, used to making decisions, and he loves to make decisions quickly, who loves to be in control of his own destiny. He's the very definition of a fighter jock. He's the guy that wants to have this is his plane. He takes it up. He does his thing. Yeah, he's got to be flying in formation and other things. But it's much more suited to him to be the loner in the aircraft than to actually have a crew. And yet he is looking for more challenges. While he was at North Weald, he'd had a couple of flights in the Bristol Bulldog. And my thinking when I saw that in the logbook, and there's even a photo of the Bulldog in his logbook, and I'm thinking, oh, you know, perhaps that's the next thing. But he had a friend, Ralph Cleland, who had done the flying boats pilot's course at RAF Calshot, which is where the School of Naval Cooperation Aerial Navigation, they ran this pilot's course, flying boats pilot's course. He had done that course, and he says to Don, it's a really good idea if you do this course. Now, Don's thinking, oh, so I've actually got to now go to from land base to sea base. I've got to go to multi-crew aircraft. It's a flying boat. This is about as far away from fighter boy as you can get. So it's a very great attraction to him. And I think it came as a surprise to me, as it did to him, that when he arrived there and he climbed into flying boats, and they were desperately slow compared with fighters, he loved them. Because it produced different challenges. And ultimately, one of the biggest challenges, which would lead to where he would make his name in his career, which is the issue of aerial navigation out over the oceans.
And this is, I think, for me, the part of your book where I was swept away, and I polished off this sort of second half from here on in. Because he's doing so much. And he's... Yeah, I think by the time he leaves, he's only a flight lieutenant or something like that, isn't he? He's achieving a lot. He's jumping on every course he can. He's getting licenses that the majority of his peers wouldn't. He's, as you said, that task-orientated mindset is making him, or enabling him, I should say, to maximize every opportunity that gets put in front of him. And that's when a notable person also enters the story as well, who will be featuring muchly in your next volume as well, in Arthur Harris.
Yes. So he goes from the flying boat pilot's course. He's posted to 210 flying boat squadron at Pembroke Dock. And he's only there a couple of months before Arthur Harris arrives. Now, interestingly, Arthur Harris had done the flying boat pilot's course immediately after Don. Both had come through with above average ratings, and Arthur Harris had arrived at Pembroke Dock with the distinct view that flying boats should be up at night, but the flying boat fraternity was of the view that flying boats should not go up at night. And he was there ostensibly to prove them all wrong. And what is interesting in one of the, I explore the early relationship between Don and Arthur Harris, it's going to be a much bigger issue as we come into volume two, is that they were very much alike, those two. And Don hears his wing commander say, hey, listen, we're going to get these flying boats up at night. He jumps at the chance. This is the sort of challenge that he relishes, is it hasn't been done before, so I'm going to be one of the people that's going to show you that it can be done. And again, this is one of the themes of the book, is that if somebody says to Don, it can't be done, Don goes, okay, assess the risk. Oh, yes, it can be done. I'm confident with these things have to happen. If we do these things, it can be done. Group think, no, it can't be done. Don, yes, it can. And this is illustrated for the first time at Pembroke Dock, where Arthur Harris is saying, let's get them up at night. And Don says, okay, let's go and do it. And as one of his flight commanders, which is what he was, they went over to Calshot, and he was up 30-something times at nighttime, demonstrating that really it was absolutely possible. And this made, amongst other things, made a lasting impression on Harris, was that they were similar beings in a way. They love technology. They love development. They love to make decisions, get on with things. They were, if you told them something couldn't be done, they would say, well, yes, it can be. They both had a sense, in fact, Harris regarded himself as Rhodesian much more than English. He felt himself something from the colonies as well. So a little bit of that colonial side of things. They both had a very great distaste for bureaucracy, especially if it got in the way of development. So we see, even though there's an 18-year difference in age, there is a certain coming together, a meeting of the minds, a consensus ad idem, which sees them bond in a way that even though they were only together for 4 months at Pembroke Dock, they made lasting impressions on each other.
And that's amazing, isn't it? It's such a short period of time that that initial sort of bumping of them together will have so much to come. But we're not going to talk about that because that's a different book that I don't think we finished writing yet.
Just to pick up on the license thing, though, while he was there, he got his – let me make sure that I get this all in order. At Pembroke Dock, he got his B pilot's license, which was his civil aviation license, and he got his second class navigator's license, which was a civil license as well. He was then posted back to Calshot for 2 years as a lecturer. Now, here is a guy that hated school and now he is a teacher. You can imagine how that went down. So he actually managed to get a job as an instructor on the flying boats pilot's course. So within months of actually having been a student on the course, he was now a lecturer and he got his seaplane instructor certificate. But while he was there at the beginning of 34, he got his first class navigator's license. He then went on to get his A, C and X ground engineer's licenses. And then for good measure, the wireless operator's license. And it was considered that he could do Morse code as fast as any trained operator. So effectively, by the time he leaves there in August 35 to head to Imperial Airways, he has all the licenses that you can get.
And he did like to say that he got them before some other people as well, didn't he? You made that note that he wasn't shy of coming forward of talking about his achievements.
Well, it's one of the things that I challenge is it's repeated over and over again in articles and books on Don Bennett is that he claimed to be the seventh holder in the world of the first class air navigator's license. I just put a couple of paragraphs in that which sort of put a little bit more context that perhaps that may not have been true. It may well be that he thought that he was the seventh holder of that particular license in the world, but I think that there's sufficient evidence to indicate that perhaps that wasn't the case. That he wrote in his memoirs, by the way.
Was it print the legend, yeah. But the thing that...
That's right.
I cannot thank Ian Campbell enough for joining us here on the Damcasters. His book, Relentless Skies, The Life of Australia's Pioneer Aviator and Wartime Commander, Air Vice Marshal Don Bennett, Volume 1, The Most Efficient Airman, is out now. And I can't recommend it highly enough. And as you're going to see in part 2, when we get into the tail end of his civil years, he doesn't hold back and he does some incredible things. And that's all in Volume 1. You can find out about next week or, of course, become a Damcasteer and you can watch part 2 right now. So please do all the likes and subscribes and tell all your friends about the pod and let me know how we're doing in the comments below and whether or not a 45-minute episode is what you want or you want the full fat hour and a half interviews that I do with some of my guests. Please let me know because that will really help me to get these episodes together. So until next time, thank you so much for your support. Take care of yourselves and please do check in on your friends. It is that time of year when we can lose touch, when people need a bit of contact the most. So thanks so much for watching and listening and doing whatever you do. Until next time, take care of yourselves. Bye-bye. I just want to say many thanks to our fabulous Damcasteers on Patreon. If you head over to our Patreon page, you can join the crew and get your name in the credits from just £3 a month plus a bit of VAT. The Damcasters is hosted and produced by Matt Bone and is a Boney Abroad podcast production.